Hey everybody, this is Loy Irvin, a.k.a. the Grappling Renegade, a.k.a. the King of Leg Locks, a.k.a. America's Grappling Coach. And I'm here with my man, Jimmy Ja. After the Kenan Cornelius interview, I got raving emails and Facebook messages and people sending letters to my school asking me to please do more interviews with some of my medal chasers. So I've decided to do one with Jimmy Ja. But first, I want to clear up and talk about some of the things and some of the comments that came back from the interview that I did with Kenan Cornelius. You know, I said my position is 97% of the population are losers and never going to accomplish anything because they whine and moan. And I talked about my whole 3% philosophy. And right now, I don't have time to go into that in depth. But that's how I believe. That's how I think. And that's what I demand on my floor from my medal chasers. It's either yes or no. There is no gray area. Did you do your 1,000 drills this week? No, but is a no. Either you did your 1,000 and you're closer to getting our base level of 10,000 or you didn't. I don't want to hear any excuses. We don't want to hear any of that, okay? So it's very important that when I talk, sometimes I just talk and without explaining some of our core philosophy, some of our things that we have. So I want to share some of those with you. One of them is something that we call BJJ bitch-assness. Yes, you heard it right. It's called BJJ bitch-assness. And it's a virus that's all throughout the world in the BJJ community. And certain people are infected with this virus and don't even know it. We know it because we know all the signs of the virus. We're at the tournaments and you see someone lose. All you have to do, go to the next tournament you go to, watch a match. When you see somebody lose, go hang out. And when the loser walks off, walk over to the loser's area, the coaches, his teammates, and listen. You hear things like this if they're infected with BJJ bitch assness. Oh, don't worry about it. You almost had them. Oh, don't worry about it. You know, look at his belt. He has 3 stripes and you just got your blank belt. It's okay. It doesn't matter that you, like, what other things that through your learning about this disease have you heard?
Big one is, like, you always hear about size, like, especially absolute divisions. Like,
yeah.
Always you hear about, like, oh, no, they're just bigger than you. Like I was saying, like, you can go to any tournament wherever you want, any tournament anywhere in the country, and you can go to whoever lost, you can hear this kind of stuff, this kind of language. And, like, when you don't realize this language is what it is, you don't even recognize it. But, like, Master Lloyd introduced it to me through stuff I was saying. So I realized I had that disease coming from whatever coaching I ever got my whole life through my entire journey through sports and whatever baggage I'm carrying from whatever. But Master Lloyd kind of pointed it out exactly what it is, and, like, now that I could recognize it, so you hear it all the time, you realize that if you feel it about to come up, you feel that feeling, you know, whatever you're about to say, if you could recognize it, then now you're improving, getting better at getting rid of that disease. And there is a cure for it, but you just have to be with the right people and be with in the right situation to be able to recognize it. And if you're not in that situation, if you don't have people correcting you every day, you're never going to realize it. It's that thing where I need to be checked. If you do have it, and a lot of people do have it, you need to be checked every day. You gotta get your dose of medicine every day. It's like rehab. Think about, like, rehab or something. Like, every day you need to be getting your dose of medicine. You need to be getting corrected and getting put on the right path. So it's not, like, it's not an easy cure.
It's not an easy cure, but
everybody's probably got a little bit of it. You know what I mean? Especially if, you know what I mean, if you don't, now if you're just first time hearing it, then you probably definitely have a little bit somewhere, you know what I mean?
Just in case you don't know who Jimmy Ja is, Jimmy Ja was Team Lloyd Irvin's very first person to do the Grand Slam. You saw that Kenan Cornelius this year won the World Championships, the Brazilian Nationals, the Europeans, and the Pans, winning all of the four majors, calling it the Grand Slam. And not only did that, he won his division and he won the Open division, so it's like a double Grand Slam at the purple belt level. But Jimmy in 2011 won the Grand Slam at the brown belt level, and we're going to talk about his philosophy and what happened and how this happened and how, you know, his progression to that level. But let's go back to the BJJ bitch asses, because it is very, very important. Because if you have this in your school or you have this within your team, you need to rid yourself of it, or at least understand when someone is infected with it and understand what it is. To go even further, you can look at people's blogs. When a person writes after a tournament, go around and look at people's Facebook statuses and listen to what they write. Look at people's blogs. You'll hear instructors say something like that: "My student so and so, giving up 45 pounds, fought valiantly." Listen, first of all, there's no need to point out a person giving up a certain amount of pounds if it's an absolute division. Absolute division, open division means it's open. See, when they're saying giving up 45 pounds, giving up, that means they're making excuses as to why. Or if they end up winning, they're giving, it's just bad. It is a clear-cut sign. What else? There's, don't worry about it. If you would have got that arm bar, you would have won. Like, what are you talking about? Like, listen, this disease is running rampant. I fight every single day to make sure that this disease does not get into my floors. On my metal chaser floor, our competition classes, it is gone. The people that may have it a little bit, they can't verbally express it anymore. They know better. We keep on giving them medicine after medicine. On my beginner floor and my intro classes, it's there. I mean, everyone, you know, the mass majority has it. It's bigger than AIDS, because 97%. Like 97% of the population in Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu have this. And what's even more disturbing is that a lot of high level, even world champion type instructors allow this disease to be in their school, and they support this disease instead of trying to banquet. Like, I want to get rid of it. And all my mount chasers, all of them understand what it is. They know what it is, and they now are self-regulatory within the school because they check each other. All right, we'll get back to that, but it is a disease that you have. Like, listen, don't make excuses. 3%ers don't whine. We don't complain. We don't say, oh, he grabbed my gi. Oh, he did. No. Like, back in the day, like, let's move on from there. But let me introduce you to Jimmy, for those that don't know. Like I said, Jimmy, Grand Slam. He won his brown belt division in 2011 at the European Championship, at the Pan American Championship, at the Brazilian Nationals, all the way in Brazil, and the World Championship. And, you know, winning the Grand Slam is a huge accomplishment. A lot of people, like I said, there's been people going around saying, oh, well, it doesn't matter if you win the Worlds at the blue belt, or it doesn't matter if you win the Worlds at the purple belt, or it doesn't matter if you win the Worlds at the brown belt. Let me tell you this. Any instructor that's standing in front of you, a paying student, and telling you it does not matter, it simply does not matter about winning the world at the blue, purple, brown, or tip to win. I would be willing to bet that they've never created a world champion at any level. Now, I could be wrong. It could be a small percentage, 3% of the population that believes it. But understand that, like, the reality is this. When it comes to creating the black belt world champion, right? You have Lovato, and you have BJ Penn. So it doesn't matter just about American teams. There's no Brazilian teams that have created an American champion at the black belt level. So no one's done it besides the guys that were with Lovato and BJ Penn. All the top teams, all the top black belts that are winning, you know what I'm saying? They were doing stuff at a high level at the blue, high level at the purple, high level at the brown, and some of them, you know, may just came on strong in the purple and brown. Don't lock me into what I'm saying, but get what I'm saying. These people that are talking like this have what I call BJJ bitch assness, because they're making excuses to their deficiencies. Most people, like, I did it when I very first started back in 1996, 1997. I didn't know anything about jiu-jitsu really. I had my own school. I was forced to have my own school. I got my blue belt in 30 days. I got my blue belt from Leo Dollar in 30 days. 6 months into my training, my instructor Leo Dollar had to move back to Brazil, and I was left by myself. There were other black belts in my area doing jiu-jitsu, and we couldn't beat them in gi. We were like getting dismantled. So what I did, guess what I did? I said, well, we don't do gi. We do no gi. It wasn't that we didn't do it. I loved gi. It's just that I couldn't beat them, and I couldn't produce high-level guys in the gi. So I tried to go over to this whole no gi thing, right? And we were winning no gi, but it's still BJJ bitch ass. It was in my veins. I understand this. But I made a decision once I started learning about these laws of success, these success principles, and this 97% and a 3% rule. I said, listen, I'm no longer going to make excuses. I'm going to figure out a way to beat them. When in my area, I think it was FDC Academy, Frank Cucci and Virginia Beast, in our region, they were the dominant force. Then came Yamazaki. They were the dominant force for a while. And then I had a plan to take over, beat everyone. And then we became the dominant force. And in our local area, we haven't relinquished that at all. And since then, we've gone past thinking local and thinking, you know, big international world championships. And just so you're clear, what I'm saying is this. You see, the mass majority of school owners out here, the mass majority have come from some team. You know, they were on some team, whether it's the Lions, Gracie Bar, wherever team they're from. And they went through white belt and blue belt and purple belt and brown belt and got their black belt. Some of them may have gone white belt, purple belt, white belt, blue belt, purple belt, and then switched teams and went somewhere else, brown belt and black belt. But no matter what, they have gone through a process, whether it's Alliance's process, whether it's Gracie Baja's process, and whatever process they've been through, they now go and open their own school, and then they have a base process to teach from, plus whatever they feel they want to add on to. You see, I did not have that. I was with an instructor, Leo Dalla, at Yamazaki Academy with Mario Yamazaki, for 6 months. I was the blue belt. I was the highest ranking person on my team at the time. Yamazaki Dalla Jiu-Jitsu, and I was the best at the school. I represented Yamazaki Dalla. I was the best guy, and everyone else was white belts. We had no purple belts. We had maybe like one or two blue belts. They were mediocre. So I didn't come up in a school from a team and have anything. Everything that I'm doing, I'm making up. I'm trying to figure out. I've done sports. I'm trying to put together a team. I don't know what I'm doing. I started teaching as a blue belt, and like I didn't know anything. A lot of people say, oh, well, Lloyd did it. Yeah, but I didn't know anything. And from 1996, I got my black belt in 2000. I got my black belt in under 4 years. I got my black belt in 2000. I still didn't know anything because I didn't know how to teach. I didn't know any processes. I knew what I did. I created this thing called the Grappling Blueprint. It was basically a formula and a system that allowed me to take my skill set to a different level. And then 2002, 2001-ish, you know, I started figuring things out, testing different things. But we were just average. And it wasn't until, like, when it came, like Mike Fowler came to me, I think it was a white belt, and he wanted to do what I was doing, and he believed in the system and liked what he's doing, and I invited him, and I let him come down. He moved in me. He lived with me in my house for 3 or 4 years, and I personally worked with him. He was like my prototype. So he was open, and I started teaching him, working with him with the system, right? And the system wasn't refined. We were trying to win local tournaments. Understand, my goal back then, 2002, 2003-ish, was to win Grappler's Quest, to win and dominate my local tournaments because I wanted to be the best in my area. And then Mike started doing really well. blue belt, purple belt was doing really well, traveling and so forth. And then later on, they had Ryan Hall. Ryan Hall came and saw Mike Fowler. He wanted to do what Mike Fowler, he sat down in my office upstairs on the mat and said he wanted to do whatever he can do. Can I support him? Can I help him? And I committed to him and helped him, put time and energy and effort into him. And then I remember Master Daniel was always telling me, he said, Master Lloyd, you're doing something wrong. And he said, you keep on focusing on these particular individuals. And he said, what's going to happen is if anything happens, you only have one. Like, you should start focusing on the whole team. But at the time, you know, I had my little email list. I was promoting the Grappling Blueprint, and I needed results fast because people don't believe anything until you see results. And Mike Fowler was out there doing his job, and Ryan Hall was out there doing his job. People, you know, started seeing it, and the results, people started talking, oh, wow, look at these guys. And at the time, like I said, every single, if you remember, like Ryan and Mike, anytime they won a match, I would send a video out showing you what they did, to prove my theory of what we're doing works, right? Because I believe you don't have to be a Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu world champion that to think, because most Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu world champions can't really teach good. There's some that can, but some that can't. Because the only thing that matters is results. Like, look at this guy over here who's supposed to be the best guy in the world, or this guy who's the best guy in the world, or this guy who's a four-time world champion. Like, are they creating blue belt world champions? Are they creating black belt world champions? Are they creating? And I'm not, listen, I'm talking about Americans. And like I said, and we're not just, if you're not American, not anti anything else. I'm talking about right now, we are doing the American Jiu-Jitsu movement where we're trying to create a black belt world champion. And in our quest, we're creating blue belt world champions. We're creating purple belt world champions. We're creating purple belt grand slam champions. We got brown belt grand slam world champions. We got JT Torres black belt, bronze medalist got on the stand. And we have more black belts coming up. This is the thing. So, like, please do not misquote me what I'm saying. What I'm saying is this. I've been around 15 years plus or so, but I am just figuring this thing out because I did not come up through another team and spend 10 years or 15 years in this team and have a system that I taught. See, everyone who came through me now will have a bit, if they decide to open a school, they have a base system. All right. My old model was get the guys, start putting videos out of them out there with videos, even create video series with blue belts and purple belts. And my model back then was this. Because let me tell you this. All these guys that come to be medal chasers, all you guys out here throughout the world training full-time in jiu-jitsu, at the end of the day, you're going to be broke. It is a commitment that you have to sacrifice to. You're training full-time. But at the end of the day, you can become a blue belt, purple belt, brown belt, black belt, world champion. And then when the real reality hits, you're going to be broke because you don't have any skill sets. So my original thought was, like, originally I would put my guys out there, send videos so they can become famous. And now I create video series around them so we can make some money to help support our cause. But more importantly, so that they can become famous. I've had blue belts and purple belts that are more famous internationally than black belt world champions were. Why? Because of marketing. And now my goal was for them to be famous to the point that when it's their time to open their own school, that would ride along because now they're famous, they have skill sets, and it helps them. I ran into problems with that and different things happened. So if you see me the last 2 or 3 years, you don't see me doing that anymore. What you see me doing now is promoting the team, the medal chasers. And if you think about it, Master Diane was right. He's the one who told me. If you think about this, the medal chasers now are doing things at a bigger and higher level than we've ever had ever before. So I wish I had known it, but like I said, I'm making mistakes. I'm trying to figure this out. But I have it dialed in now. And that's what it takes when I'm talking about the whole medal chaser movement. And like Jimmy Ja, just like Kenan, when he first came, his first period of time, he was not the android that I talk about, android philosophy and the grappling blueprint. He was not, he was skeptical. He wanted something different. And in the beginning, did you get phenomenal results? Like, did you win the world the first year you're here? Did you win the Pan Am the first year you're here? You went to Brazil, did the Brazilian Nationals. Did you medal there? You did the Pan Am, did you medal there? And then, the very next year, after doing absolutely nothing, he did the Grand Slam. How does this happen? So, Jimmy, can you talk to them a little bit about what we do here with the Medal Chaser program? Because the Medal Chaser program is much bigger than jiu-jitsu. Because, like I said, I feel like these are like my boys. Like I have a personal responsibility that people come here. I don't want them to be here 3, 4, 5, 6, 8 years, and then when it's time to go into the real world, they're broke and like, oh, what to do? I have a martial arts, a marketing, and business consultant where I teach business owners. They're not interested in that right now, but when they decide to go open school, they have access to me and access to that. And they have behind the scenes, they're working around it, they see it, they help out at events. So now I'm dripping on them, but they're not going to be a 4-time world champion or 8 years dedicated to a program, and then when it's time to open a school, they don't know anything about running business, right? That's not my goal. My goal is to make sure that whenever their time is done here, they move on, they have a skill set to go to the next level, whether they're interested now or not. And I don't put any pressure on. Like, talk about that a little bit, about when you first came and how it was, and you know, the transformation when you started listening.
All right, so for me, right, I'm gonna go way back. I was this is before I even was on the team or anything like that. Like, I never talked to Master Lloyd about this really. Like, for me, the reason I wanted to first come to the team, because I knew, because JT was my boy. JT's been my boy since I was 15 years old, since I was a yellow belt in jiu-jitsu. You know what I mean? I always looked up to JT, right? So now when I think back about it, the thing I wanted to do, I was lost. Like, I was super, super lost. Like, in I didn't know what I wanted to do. I had just dropped out of college. I was training a lot. I knew that I wanted to train, but I wanted to go to Brazil. I knew I wanted to go to Brazil. I knew if I worked hard, I know that JT was doing this whole thing. I got to see all the stuff that JT was doing. I was like, dang. Man, I want to see what that's about. You know what I mean? He was traveling all over the world. I remember he was going to Japan, all these places. I was like, dang, that'd be nice. You know what I mean? That'd be kind of a nice thing. I would like to do that. You know what I mean? So that was my kind of thing. I was training with JT a lot. I was able to get to Maryland for a week, and I'll never forget that week. I was living with Mike Fowler. Me and JT were staying with Mike Fowler. We were staying with Mike Fowler. We were chilling, training all week. I remember that week. You even look it up online. You could go on YouTube right now and you could look up 2010 Europeans, Team Lord Irvin, something like that. Like, there's a training session where that's my very first night. Oh, we train in the morning. I train wrestling in the morning when, like, all the guys were there, like Mike Easton, Ross Stallings, like all the guys, Mike Fowler, and I was like, oh, good. It was a super good wrestling training. We went crazy. Then we went that night, and I'll never forget that night practice, man. That night practice, like, the hardest practice I ever went through in my entire life. And I went through that, and you could watch it right now. You could watch Willie just like throw him. I was so dead that day because of how hard the day was. I was like, what the real thing was. I felt the real training. So like, you could see that in that night practice, and like after that, I knew where I needed to be. So then even though my original goal was like, oh man, I want to check out Brazil, stuff like that. But then right away I was introduced to this other whole thing. So okay, I saw that. All right, boom. We talked to Master Lloyd. Me and you had a meeting over at Poppy's right over there, literally 10 feet away from here. We talked. We told him what I wanted to do. I told him I love jiu-jitsu. What do I want to do? I just want to train, blah, blah, blah. Keep getting better, 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 better. But this is when I first came here. So that whole first year, even though I had certain goals that I wanted to do and certain things like that, but I still wasn't, my brain wasn't programmed right. So I still had all this stuff my whole life. Like I said, I've been playing sports my whole life, been dealing with coaches my whole life. So I have everything they ever put, whether it was good or bad, it was in my brain. So coming from there, I came into that situation with whatever I had for my whole life. All right, now I'm with Master Lloyd. All right. So now a lot of that whole first year is breaking through, like you talk about it, like in anytime you go to the seminars or anything like that, breaking the concrete, taking out the shit, breaking out the concrete.
Let me explain what that is. So like I have a saying that like, whether it's your family members, your coaches, your, you know, whoever it is, a lot of people put shit into your head. and then they put concrete on top of the shit, and the concrete hardens, and they put more shit and more concrete and more shit and more concrete. Like this morning, there's a guy here from he's from Australia. He's from out of country, UK or Australia, and you know he's here. He wants to learn the mindset stuff. But like when we're rolling, every time that he would get like say if a knee hit him in the head, he was like, oh hold on, ho. Okay, like that 7 second break that he took, see that's conditioning. Like if you get knee in the head here, if your head's not bust open where you need stitches or you have a knot or you don't have a concussion, you have to keep going. They know it. They won't even dare stop. See, because why are you stopping? Like I have no problem. I don't want you to get injured. But if you get a knee and you stop and you rub it and you shake your head out and you're ready to go again in 4 to 7 seconds, that's not an injury. Somebody allowed you to do that. So obviously at your school, you're allowed to do that. So that's some shit with concrete. So my job here is to break up that concrete and take that next level of shit out and then work on next level concrete. You can keep going.
So where were we? So I came into the situation and like that, even that whole first year, so this was 2010. I got here January 2010, the beginning of 2010. This is when I first came to that first whole kind of trial week where I did my tests, my where I came to the gym, I trained every day, see what it was like. But already the first day I was already hooked, so it didn't even matter. So by the end of the week, Master Lloyd hit me up on a text message saying basically I could come down, I could live down here, and all I had to worry about was training. So I was like, okay. I was like, this is exactly what I was looking for. Alright, yeah, I'm down. I come through, like I said, I still had all that stuff in my head, all that stuff I was dealing with. So that whole process of really, it's like building trust too, like, because I really came in, I didn't know Master Lloyd, I didn't really know what he was about. I have with my own perceptions from, because I grew up in the whole New Jersey, New York grappling scene where all the grapplers quest and stuff like that. So I seen him before as a kid, 14-year-old, 15-year-old, seen him as a kid, I had all those, I didn't know really what he was about. So it's about trust and building trust with your instructor, you know what I mean? So it was us really getting to know each other. And I was still doing my own thing throughout the competitions, all the tournaments. So I started off right away. Right when the first week I was on the team, I was already going to Europe. I went out to Europe. You sent me out to Europe.
Yeah.
I got third in Mayo Posada brown belt. You know, it's all right, you know what I mean? It's like, I was still at that point too, because through the whole thing, at least for me growing up, I've always been playing sports, so I always knew about the concept of winning and losing. You know what I mean? So just the fact that I understood that that's what it is, and that I don't want to lose, I want to win. So I'm like, you know what I mean? All right, keep going. Because I'm training harder than I ever trained my whole entire life. I think, oh yeah, I'm doing good. I go to Pan Ams. I got third. Same thing. I think I'm doing all right. Then from there, like I guess I don't know if I got comfortable in the situation or whatever it was. Brasileiros, I got destroyed by this guy, Jose Carlos. I got destroyed bad. Like, remember that? I remember Master Lloyd was filming the thing, and I knew it was bad because I was in the match. I looked down, and there was nobody else filming. I was like, all right. So I was like, now I know I'm really messing up. You know what I mean? So we come through that. I go to Worlds. I'm still feeling confident in Worlds because of how hard we've been training. Because I like understand like the training here, like in Camp Springs, is nothing like you're not gonna find this anywhere else in the country. I don't know. The training is so crazy. I don't know if you find anywhere else in the world how precise, how scientific, how everything is planned. It's like, I don't even know how to explain it. Like, you just have to go through it to be able to understand what it actually is. So, just getting confidence from that, I'm like, all right, you know what I mean? I'm going to do good, good, do it. Still think, same thing. It's all about the positions that I didn't drill that I was going for, and I got caught. So, it's my fault 100% because Master Lloyd showed me exactly what I needed to do, but because of whatever I had, I didn't do it. Right?
Yep.
So now I'm sitting here in this situation. So say after Worlds, I lost second round, nothing.
Second round clown.
No, I mean second round clown. Like this is what, now see, I understand for my family and everything like that. By this time, this is what I dedicated my life to. I dropped out of school completely. Everything else, I said no. I'm doing jiu-jitsu, blah blah. First time around, nothing. I'm like, all right, I got nothing to show for it. I go out, go back home. We had a big talk. I remember this was like super super important. Big talk. I was about to go. I go every year. I go camping with my dad. I go camping, but right before that, we had a talk. And we're talking about what I need to do, blah blah. And I remember that was super important for me because then I had time to think about it. And when I came back, it was like I had that think and grow rich. Like everything we're talking about, like we're probably talking about 97%, 3% whole thing, but like that whole thing comes from like think and grow rich. And now, so the most important bad thing about the first step for think and grow rich is having that burning desire. So that's when I really started building that, like, I feel it deep down, like burning desire to do something, to want to win, to be a champion, stuff like that. So that started building up. And then I got injured in that summer. So I had to sit out the whole summer. I wanted to do ACC trials, stuff like that. Like all the stuff I had planned that I wanted to do in my head, I couldn't do it. But that whole time, I had that burning desire building, deep down, building. But also, while I couldn't train, luckily the whole system Master Lloyd has set up, so I'm not just doing jiu-jitsu. That whole time, I got like, I even had a bug for internet marketing and like SEO, and so I started learning all this stuff. Like, I had the opportunity to learn all this stuff, like crazy, crazy stuff. So I'm like, at the time I was what, like 19, 20 years old? 19 years old.
19.
And I started learning about search engine optimization, like all this crazy stuff, like internet marketing, being introduced to this whole other world. Okay. All right, I see that Master Lloyd. I'm seeing it in real life every day. When I'm working, I can work every day with Master Lloyd. I can see what he's doing, and I can watch him literally making $100,000, million. Like I'm seeing it happen. So I'm getting experience from him doing it. I'm getting experience. So the whole time, boom, boom, boom. So the whole time I'm injured, I'm working on another skill set. And then the whole time I'm still thinking about jiu-jitsu, 100% concentrating on jiu-jitsu. So now, by the time when it's me to get healthy. I'm healthy, I could dedicate everything 100% to jiu-jitsu, but the whole time I was injured, I didn't just waste time and be all sad and be all depressed about my situation. I was able to put my energy into a whole nother skill, a whole totally 100% different. We're talking about Brazilian jiu-jitsu, and we're talking about internet marketing, or something like it's, there's nothing that, well, there is something, that's like the, we always talk about the spooky stuff, but there is something that connects it all, but to 100%, like there's no other situation where I would be able to do both of that unless I was in Camp Springs, Maryland, PG County, Maryland. You know what I mean? So that's what unique about the situation. Like,
take them to. You just told them about the year you didn't win at all.
Yeah.
Let's talk about what changed. Like what all changed?
Right. All right.
You know, going into the Grand Slam.
All right. So we came out. It was around January, early January, so it just turned to be 2011. I did now I'm talking about the experiences that I get, different experiences in different situations. So I did a presentation in front of, well, we already did one for the mastermind. I did a presentation in front of the mastermind, and I like anybody who was there who knows, I was like, man, like, I could barely talk. Remember this? I was like, so nervous that I couldn't even like get across. I felt like I completely messed up totally.
Public speaking is one of the most feared things on earth, and we have a program for our little ninjas, 2-year-olds, 3-4-year-olds, all of our kid programs, so that we have teenagers and adults that come out that don't have this problem. It's what we're doing here is much bigger than just jiu-jitsu, but like I said, we put him on the stage. He had a fear, but we worked through it now. You can speak. Keep on.
So I had that whole thing. So I remember the whole thing was it coincides perfectly. So it's like, I got, when I was injured, I got super, super, remember I went crazy. I got super like obsessed with marketing, like all this stuff, Facebook fan pages, all, like I went crazy. Like,
you started getting paid by people too.
And and I had these situations where people, I was like, all right. So this is pretty cool. It's a whole different thing. Like, now think about it, I'm starting to get emotional about it. So I'm like, all right, so that whole thing happened, but then one time when I got finally healthy, I healed up. So now I'm like, all right, the thing that's been really burning down inside me for a while now has been this jiu-jitsu stuff. So I need to get that out of me. So basically, once I got healthy, it was like probably a week or two before Europeans, and I came up to Master Lloyd, and I was like, Master Lloyd, because JT already had his ticket, a few of the other dudes already had their tickets, so I was like, is it cool if I compete in Europeans? Because he didn't even know if I was ready to compete or not. So I asked him. He said, yeah, you should. Like, we should have told me earlier. Like, we should have been done. Like, did this? You know, he registered for everything. So then right away I go out, but because of my head, I've been in my head like you keep this stuff at that time. At that time too, I was seriously studying the game plan. I was giving the books, like the product that you made. When did you make that?
2002-ish.
So like a
2003, I think it was.
Maybe a 7-8 year old product. And I've been studying this whole time I was injured. So I understood kind of, I'm studying Think and Grow Rich, all the books that MSLO gave me, Outliers, all the stuff, the whole process, the beginning process that you get put on when you first get here. And so I was already getting through that. So that was about to hit. You know what I mean? The whole time I was trying to learn about this stuff, trying to understand, trying to grasp for the idea of it. And now I'm starting to finally understand, okay, now if I do this, all right, I'm going to figure it out slowly. And I started having little glimpses of it. I started, there's some grappling quests I did, and so it's starting to really, like, my game was really starting to pick up. And in the gym, too, like, I was just really getting it. And the stuff that Master Lloyd had taught me when I first came here, I was really starting to put into my game. And now, so I'm training, where we did the Europeans. And when Europeans, keep training, now hard training, the whole team's training, so we have everybody training, DJ, all those guys. Then, who else came in 2001?
But. During that year, we used to do film, so we practiced. Yeah. In school. We videotaped the training in school. We videotaped the drilling, and we would work on the drilling, and then we would videotape what happened in the tournament, and then we would come back and review it and show one little error. Because remember the back tape?
Yep.
The back tape, yeah. It was successful, and then that constant progression, and you started fixing things as we were going up, and that also helped.
But it's like if you don't have, like we said before about as far as the mindset thing, like. You're never gonna get your mindset corrected if you don't have that constant correct, like somebody being able to correct you. So like, no matter what, whatever I'm doing, I'm lucky to have a person like Master Lloyd, who's already has all these other different skill sets that he's already mastered, that can correct me in those skill sets while I'm coming up. So I always have that constant. All right, you know, like if I'm messing up, it's known that I'm messing up, and I know that I'm messing up because he's telling me. So that's constant correction in multiple. Fields, like we're not talking about just like when we're sitting here now, like we're talking to probably right now, we're talking to like mostly jiu-jitsu people right now that are watching us talk right now, you know what I mean? Right. But it's not just like, the thing is not just about jiu-jitsu, like the whole if I want to get good at jiu-jitsu, I believe 100% and 97% 3% thing, like how I have to act, like, so if you read Think and Grow Rich, it talks about if indecision, fear, stuff like that, like if you have any of that, it's not you're not going to be able to be successful. So now if I know that, that's how it is in jiu-jitsu, and that since, just because my whole life I've been training jiu-jitsu since I was 14, I know that's what I'm best at, so now I could experience that whole thing through jiu-jitsu, that's the first thing I experienced through, but now I know how to apply it in different things. So now we're not just talking about, like that's what I'm trying to say, we're not talking about just jiu-jitsu right now.
The people that don't understand that will just think that you have special access to something, yeah. or you're lucky,
yeah.
Because I've been studying the exact same thing. I was 26 years old, slam broke. When Mike Fowler lived with me in my house, I was probably 12, 13 times I was behind on my my note, maybe get ready to lose our house. But it was when it finally clicked, and now I'm able to transfer this same exact principles and concept that we're talking about from grappling to martial arts school to business to internet marketing to real estate investing, from niche to niche to niche to niche, because the rules and laws of success are the rules.
So it's like for you anybody who's listening, like you have the it's possible for you right now to go to Barnes & Noble and buy a book, buy a bunch of pieces of paper with letters written on it, that's information to put in your brain that can teach you the steps to success in anything you want. But for me it's a whole process. So for me coming to the situation, first you're being told exactly what it is, I'm getting put into my brain, but everything against it is pushing away, so I got to break through all that stuff. And now you see it all, it's your whole thing, you know what I mean? So it's like the only way you're really gonna get through it. So I asked Master Lloyd before, like, I have people in my life that I want to help, that I want to see be successful, and I know they're in situations where they just don't know. And the problem is, if you don't know, you can't complete, you can't do it. So, like I said, it's that whole thing where you have somebody correcting you all the time. Like, you can't, like, remember I said I asked you, like, I know I want to help my friend out. I want to, like, what can I do? And you said, like, really, like, You can give them the books. You can give them any book you want, but they need to be in the process. Like, in the or process. Be not yeah, like, in a process, but like it just so happens that my process completely covers like not just jiu-jitsu, all martial arts. Not even like you're thinking like just MMA. Not even just MMA. Like we're talking about self-defense. These little like chin out like martial arts. I don't know. I don't want to get into that right now. Like just like. It's so in depth that it's crazy. So it's like, so basically like when I started here, I was 100% Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu guy. The only martial art I really knew was Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, sport Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, like really like that whole thing. Just that was the only thing I knew. So I always had an interest. I always kind of like was interested in other martial arts stuff like that. So when I came to Master Lloyd, I started learning Jiu-Jitsu. And then he started teaching me stuff that was not jiu-jitsu. It's not jiu-jitsu. As far as Brazilian jiu-jitsu, all the techniques that are in Brazilian jiu-jitsu, it's not jiu-jitsu. So he started teaching me stuff from Russian Sambo, Sistema, Chin Na for right now. Right now, my biggest thing right now, my biggest obsession right now is Chin Na. So it's yeah. like as a, right now, all I really like, I'm really focusing right now is Chin Na. So like, if you don't know what it is, you could look it up, you could search it online, but right now that's what I'm mostly into right now. So like I came in here not, I think as a straight jiu-jitsu guy, and I've been introduced, not even, now we're just talking about martial arts. So I'm talking about different martial arts that I'm now been opened up to from Master Lloyd. So even with that, and the whole martial arts is a whole other different subjects, how to run businesses, how to, all the internet marketing, regular marketing, direct response marketing, like what I'm reading Dan Kennedy books, I'm reading what other like 21-year-old jiu-jitsu guy has an opportunity where he could learn all this stuff? Like, and that's what I said. Like, it's crazy because I'm coming into this situation as just a jiu-jitsu guy. Like, I know there's a bunch of like there's hundreds, maybe thousands of other people out there that are just like me that are just trying to learn jiu-jitsu, trying to whatever for whatever reason we love martial arts, we love grappling, and then that led me to this situation where I'm introduced to this person right here, who's opened my eyes to hundreds of different things, crazy things. I know for a fact that within probably I say 3 to 5 years, I'll be a millionaire on some other stuff that's not even has to do with anything, with martial arts or anything like that. Like I'll be able to, like he's talking about, like I'm learning stuff about multiple income streams, like the stuff that's just getting put in my brain now that I'm digesting that I'm not even like really understanding right now, that maybe I'll understand in 2 to 3 years. That's the thing about the system, though. That's the system. Like the system works in weird ways, where when you're in the system, you're getting fed all this information, and right away you're not using it. But as long as you stay in the system, I know in 2 to 3 years down the line, maybe 5 years down the line, I know if I stay in it for 10 years down the line, that I'm gonna be all right. I'm gonna be like, I don't want, like I can't even think about it right now what the possibilities are because of my certain situation now at my age. And like Master Lloyd talks about it, how he started when he was 20, he got into it when he was 26. Now that I'm a person that's getting all this information flushed in my head.
I didn't get into it until I was 30-ish. Yeah. I started jiu-jitsu when I was 26.
Yeah, when you started jiu-jitsu when he was 26. Not that goes the same way, too, because the stuff that he's teaching me, that he learned when he was 26, I'm learning when I'm 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26. Before I even get to 26, I already have this stuff getting, all that stuff stuffed into my brain, you know what I mean? And it's just like, I know that for a fact, if as long as I stay with Master Lloyd, as long as I listen to Master Lloyd and do whatever he tells me to do, I'm going to be alright. And not even just alright, because like my experience now as a 21-year-old, like I've been all over the world. Like I got, because we're, hold on. I got my passport right here, right? My passport, okay? It's my name right here. I like to label all my things, right? My dad taught me that, Jim, right? All my stuff. You look at my passport, I've been all over the world. Stickers from all over the world right now. So if you look at my joint, boom. Visas from Brazil. I've been in Brazil 5 times, 4 times, everywhere. Stamped, filled. All that stuff filled, man. It's because of this guy, man. This guy showed me the way, man. I can't give enough, like I'm really nothing without this dude, man. Like what, all the situations, everything that happened in my life to lead me to this point. Now I'm here. Now I have to take as much advantage of the situation as I can. So I'm trying to absorb everything. You know what I mean? Like, now we're talking, like I said, we're talking a lot of jiu-jitsu people right now, but it's not just, it's not at all.
It's bigger than
jiu-jitsu. It's not even at all, I guess it started, well, for you it started with jiu-jitsu too. The reason you got into it is because of jiu-jitsu.
Yep, he's crazy.
So it's like, we have that whole thing, that the reason we're here to this other whole philosophy is because of jiu-jitsu. But it's not just, now that we know about the whole other thing, that it's not just about jiu-jitsu. So
because at the end, when you're 30, 40, 50 kids, grandkids, whatever you have, like what happened to you? Like what did you do? Like what's your legacy? But let me say something that's very important that's different than most. Like so, like if you listen to Keenan's interview, you hear commonalities. You listen to Jimmy's interview, you have commonalities. But it's not me as much as me as far as the process. It's them too, because they're open. I wrote an article in 1999. I wrote an article saying the absolute worst belt on earth is the purple belt. See, because a good purple belt can tap brown belts and can tap some black belts, and they have good you know, that are good at level with their technique, and they think that they're black belts, or they think that they're better than they are, then they think that they know more than they know, but you can't prove it to them because they can technically catch some people. So they think that proving it to them or knowing is about who can tap who, when that has nothing to do with it. Like, say, for example, I've had students I've argued with and going back and forth with and battled trying to take the concrete up, but their concrete was hard. And they believed at the blue belt level, they believed at the purple belt level that they knew the thing, right? Well, I always say the same thing. Well, when it's your time and it's your turn, you know, do your thing and let's see what type of results you get, right? But like Jimmy, he was open. He allowed the person to come in and take the conquer out because he was open. The Keenan, for example, Keenan, like I said, right now, Keenan's first person ever to double grand slam. You know, Keenan has natural confidence. He wants to go out here and immediately fight the best brown belts that there are. He wants to become a black belt world champion. That's what he's working towards. But imagine if Keenan had thought that he knew everything. Like just last night, we're working with Keenan. Like he's asking about the spider guard. Like he wants to learn. He doesn't think he knows everything. He doesn't think he already mastered things, right? And that's what it takes, because if no matter where you're at, let me tell you this, no matter where you're at in the world, let me tell you about this too. We call ourselves Team USA, the America's Jiu-Jitsu team, but we have guys here that visit from Australia. We have guys here that come from other countries. We're not anti anyone else, all right? It's just that's my marketing thing. We're America's Jiu-Jitsu team. We're trying to create American Black Belt World Champion. We've created Blue Belt, Purple Belt, Brown Belt World Champions, Americans. We've created Grand Slam Champions at all the belt levels. And we got a bronze medal with JT Torres at the black belt level, and we're trying to get this black belt world championship. At the same time, on my other side, my other alter ego, we're trying to, you know, we already have a UFC champion in Dominic Cruz. We have a bunch of fighters in the UFC climbing the ladder. And you know, that's what it's about as far as the instructor, getting on these ladders and reaching, trying to reach my goals. But I want to make sure, if you're from another country, I'm not just America, USA, USA. And no matter where you are in the world, don't let anybody tell you you can't do something, because I'm a black guy in Maryland. People laugh at Maryland and PG County, think it's a joke, but we got some of the best jiu-jitsu training in the entire country right here in PG County, right? You know, it's a joke when you talk about it, but it's not a joke when the results come out.
You come train.
Yeah, you come train. But listen, no matter where you're at, don't let anyone tell you, because they told me, oh, unless you're under a black belt, there's no way that you can ever do that. But I'm not silly. I understand that I can't not be under a black belt and not know what I'm doing without having a major burning desire to learn, a major burning desire. I went to seminars, I watched videotapes, I break down film. I mean, I did a lot of stuff. And like I said, just in the last probably 4 or 5 years, I'm starting to get a grasp of what's going on. And right now, I believe I have it dialed in 100%. I understand this. The whole 97%, 3%, people on our floor have our same mentality. There's no guarantee that they're going to be world champions. There's no guarantee this. But I can guarantee you this. People that are on our medal chaser floor, people that are on our competition floor, they're 100% in the same mindset. We don't let anyone outside. If you're not in the same mindset, you have to get off the floor. Wherever you're at and wherever you're training at, you need to do the same thing. You need to sit around and listen to what language is happening in the locker room. See what's happening on the mat. If you roll out of bounds and the guy, hold my knee, in 30 seconds he's back rolling. Listen, if someone here rolls off the floor, if they get injured and need to stop, they're done for the day. You have to be injured. Don't stop. If you're in Brazil at one of these big four, you're trying to win the world championships and someone knees you in the head and you try to stop and say, hold off, wait, like time out, like, that guy's on your back choking you. And then you look at the referee with your hands up talking about, I got hit and I was trying to get, no. It's over, all right? So you train these things in the school. You train these things every single day in the mat so they don't happen. Training everything. Jordan had a situation where he did fake shake hands or did something and sat down. I'm not sure. I didn't see what happens. But like I said, I'm not about cheating, but I'm about winning. Other people cheat. And understand, people will cheat. So you have to make sure that you're practicing every single day to make sure that you don't get cheated. For example,
they're cheating on a whole different level too, you know what I mean?
Yeah, they're cheating on, cheating is crazy. Yeah. But if you go out of bounds at a tournament and you have a grip that you know is a good grip, that's your grip, that you're going to get you into the medal round, or this is the finals of the worlds. I was talking about Kyotera's match, because Kyotera match, he went out of bounds or something, and he had a grip behind Bruno's back with a lapel, and they said stop and move him back in. They came back in, and when he tried to get that grip back, Bruno would not let him, and they said no, and there was an argument. Listen, he had that grip, but at our school, we had that grip, and the referee said stop. We said hold, ref, please, come here, look. Listen, I have this grip, left hand behind his back. Under his arm. I need this grip back. Or I say, drag me back, please. I don't want to lose this. And some of you may think this is extreme, but it cost him the match. Maybe that grip that he wasn't allowed to get back, which is a strong grip for him, or for most people, could have won the match, right? But if they pull you back, the other guy cheats. He didn't want to lose.
He started to scoot a little bit.
You had one hook and you had both legs tangled. Now you can't get both. No. These look like we have thousands of these little tiny things that we practice and rehearse in school and practice so these things don't happen to us. And if something does happen to us that we weren't prepared for, understand, it's now part of the system. Constant evolution. Constant trying to take it to the top. Another thing I want to say is this. I want to make sure no matter where you're at in the world, no matter where you're at in the country, like I said, just train. Like, shut up and train. Stop thinking you know everything. Like, if you think you know more than your instructor and he can't do anything for you, leave. Go to another school. Go to another team. But listen, the head guy is the head guy. He has a process. You either believe in the process or you don't believe in the process. Like we said, when Keenan said and Jimmy said, when they first came, of course they believed in the process, but they still got that concrete. This system, this arm lock system. When I first tried to show him some wrist locks and some stuff that's really unorthodox, that's not in jiu-jitsu, they say, oh, well, you're stronger. Oh, you can do it because it's not. Oh, they're making excuses and reasons why I can do it, but they couldn't be able to do it. Now he's doing it and doing it to everyone else. Everyone, can I learn that? Yeah, you can learn it, but you're still going to have to go through the 6 months to 12 months to 18-month grind. I'm going to show you something right now. I'm going to share with you something right now that is really done to improve your grip strength and improve your wrist locking ability and this whole thing that we have. I'm going to have Jimmy show. And if you do it, great. If you don't, 97% of you won't do it. But this is what we do for real. This I could put it on a videotape and sell it, or I could never show it. And Jimmy probably don't want me to have him do it. But the fact of the matter is 97% of you are not going to do it. 3% of you are going to do it. You're going to get great benefits, but there's still a system. Hey, show them the hand movements. Tell them right now. Show them the process and the sequence of what they need to do.
The chin also?
I mean, just the grip strength.
All right. So you start easy. This is basic easy. You can do it anytime. You can do it when you're driving. You could do it when you're just chilling. Whenever you're chilling, watching TV. Anytime you, literally, at any point in your entire life, you could do this, right? Unless you don't have both your hands. So, at any point, all the way open, all the way closed. All the way open,
all the way... Don't laugh at this. This is real stuff.
All the way closed. All the way open, all the way closed. Now, basically, the set of this is all the way open, all the way closed. As fast as you can go, all the way open, all the way as fast as you can go. the number of sets right now. I'm trying to aim for 180. The 180 is the basic set. 180 is the basic
start.
So that's the set. That's the set right there. 180. I'm counting off 180 in my head. So I'm going for it until 180. When I hit 180, that's when I can stop. That's my set. And I practice that every day. I can do that whenever I want, any day. It's not anything you need anything for. It's not anything you need to be anywhere for. You don't need to be a special place. You need to go to the gym. You don't need to do anything. You can just be chilling, talking on. We're chilling here, talking on camera right now. You know what I mean? Talking to all these people. It's the same thing. I can do this whenever I want. I do this all day. I do this. I teach this because I teach. Master always give me the opportunity to teach. So I can teach every day. I teach white belts every day. So now every day all the white belts are doing this. I know. Every day they're going through it.
Show them the next drill.
Anything like that. Boom. Just fingers. Boom. Now I'm just working my fingers, my fold.
All the way up.
All the way up, all the way closed. I'm just going.
And when you first start, it's going to give you a burn like you've never felt before. But you'll work through it, and then the burn will go away.
Just remember the number. 180 is a set. When you hit 180, then you're good. But then you keep working from there, and how fast you can get it. And I say, the Chinese people, like the Chinese masters for Chin Na, the guys are doing it. They're doing 180 reps in 30 seconds. So imagine 30 seconds go by, and they're just rapping with my things falling off. Doesn't matter, man.
Show the next one. Go slow so you can see. From pinky inside. I will stop there because some of them probably boring. Some of them probably think it was boring. But for you that don't think it's boring, do it. Do it. And then your wrist catches and your wrist locks. You got a wrist lock up the Grappler's Quest Black Belt Open Division this past weekend, right?
Yep.
Yeah. Like, wrist locks. Listen, most people do not know how to defend wrist locks. Most people don't know all the wrist lock attacks, and the people that do it don't take the time to learn. It's like the Chinas. So let's go back to wherever you're at in your world, and you want to get to a high level, you got to train. You got to have a system. You got to take the concrete out your own head. If you don't have anyone taking the concrete out your own head, at least understand what BJJ bitch assness is. If you know what BJJ bitch assness is, and you understand it is a vile, cruel disease that is plaguing jiu-jitsu mats throughout the world, if you can recognize it, then you had the first step of being able to combat it. Like, if you lose, you lost. Don't make any excuses for your loss. Go back and work to improve, why you lost, because they may laugh at this, but it's serious. I mean, it's serious. Like, go to the next tournament, see someone lose, walk over, and I'm guaranteeing you're going to hear BJJ bitch asses. You have anything to say on that?
Well, it's like the whole, like, so, as far as BJJ bitch asses goes, if you want success, you need to be in a complete opposite. So, like, if you look at, like, I don't think these are on the internet or anything, but, like a lot of my matches from Brasileiros 2011, like, all those matches, like, we have some footage. I know we have some footage. I've seen it. Like, it's like the before and after match, before and after the matches. It's like auto suggestion. So it's super important. They talk about it in Think and Grow Rich. They talk about it in any other success thing you're gonna roll. Like programming your own brain to believe a certain thing. So if I want to win this tournament, I have to believe 100% I'm gonna win this tournament. If I have any doubt that I might lose that tournament, I'm probably not gonna win it. You know what I mean? Like I need to believe 100%. I'm going into that tournament that I'm gonna win it. You know what I mean? So, like when I remember that was the most important thing for me. Like when I got into that whole thing, I really like so for me it came to the point where I lost the first year I was on the team, I lost. So the next year I came on, I was like, look, Master Lloyd, I really don't care about anything. I don't care about anything in the whole world. I really don't care about anything. Nothing really matters. I want to win this. So what do I have to do? He told me exactly what I have to do. He told me exactly the things I have to say. I have to put into my brain. We're talking about when I wake up in the morning, I'm programming this into my brain. I wake up in the morning, the first thing I say is this what's it called?
Mantra.
Okay, I got a mantra, okay?
Keenan told
it. Yeah. So if you know about a mantra, all right, I'm saying the same exact thing every day. I know exactly what I want. I know the goal I have set out. I know exactly what I want. And I'm saying that every day, every night, before I go to sleep, And when I wake up,
this,
right
this,
away.
This is going back to the spooky stuff.
Yeah, we're getting spooky. We're programming our brains.
We talked about some spooky stuff. My Grappling Creed. If you haven't seen it, go www.mygrapplingcreed.com. People think it's some marketing hokey pokey stuff, but it's real. Anything that the mind can conceive and believe, it can achieve. If you haven't watched Earl Nightingale's The Strangest Secret, make sure you Google YouTube Earl Nightingale's The Strangest Secret. This is old school stuff. I wasn't alive. My parents weren't alive. This is real stuff. You know what I'm saying? I'm real proof. If you think that my parents are rich, or you think that I won the lottery, or you think that I'm having this type of success with the jiu-jitsu, or my businesses, or the internet, or all the stuff that I'm doing, if you think that it's luck, or you think that someone, you know, in my family knew all this and helped me, if you think that, you're silly. You're silly.
Yeah, he said, like this is what we've been talking about since the beginning of this whole time we've been filming.
The whole interview is just about that success.
It's about the thing. It's not, we're not, like as I said, it's like, you can apply it to jiu-jitsu, but we're not just talking about jiu-jitsu. The whole thing, if you go out of here and you just think we're just talking about jiu-jitsu, that's not what it is. We're talking about this whole thing that you can apply to anything. Like I said, like, I know as a 21-year-old now, I know within a few years I'm going to be a millionaire. I know for a fact that no matter what, because of the situation I'm in, because of what I'm getting.
But the guys out there think that somehow I've brainwashed you. Like you're just brainwashed. Yeah. Like okay, you won the Grand Slam the year after, you didn't win anything. I brainwashed you to believe that you could do that. I brainwashed you to believe that you could win the world. I brainwashed you to do all the stuff you've already done. And now you want to become rich doing other things. That's brainwashed, because there's no way you could do that. I mean, I've been told that. There's no way I could do that, or no way I could do this, or there's no way a black guy from Maryland is ever going to have a successful jiu-jitsu team. Why? Because everyone's in Brazil and everyone's on the West Coast, and there's no high level. Like, don't listen to none of them.
It doesn't matter.
And once you do it, then they say, well, you won't make $100 million. Oh well, you won't be a black belt world champion. Oh well, you, like, it's all like 97% of the 97%, yeah. No matter what.
And there's no way. So, like, even talking, I talk to a lot of people too now. I want a little bit, and so people know my name a little bit. So they'll talk to me and they'll tell me.
And people know the name a little bit, but understand this: if Jimmy had came around during the time that my model was sending out every single video of him every time he won all around the world, and I let him do video series, he would be a bigger star just about as everyone else, right? Same thing with Keenan, same thing with DJ, who has well over 200 Chimera locks, you know. But we're undercover now, the Metal Chasers.
So it's more like an underground thing where we're trying to push this philosophy. Like I said, it's not jiu-jitsu, it's this other philosophy that we're bringing to jiu-jitsu into it. So now we're trying to turn that to what it is, to how you can be a champion, because that's the only way. Like, especially as far as Americans go, we're already kind of programmed because of what we've ever been taught. We've been gone through the school system, whatever. Like, this is like the thing we've been, it coincides with it. It works with it the best. So, like, I came into this situation, I came to Team Lord Irvin as a brown belt, but it worked out so well. The fact that everything I've ever been taught and everything I've ever done coincides perfectly. It blended perfect, like whatever. I don't know. Just maybe I'm lucky, or I don't know what it is. Whatever situation that I came into this, like, I could just explode into it. But it's just how everybody is.
It's a law of attraction.
Yeah, exactly.
But it's more spooky stuff that just so happened that guys who come and get attracted to what we're doing, and get attracted to what we're about in our mindset, and want to become a part of this. Because understand this, there's people all throughout the world that know for a fact in their heart that they can be good, or maybe really good, know they're in a situation where they can't get any better, and they're just stuck, you know what I'm saying? And they know it, and, you know, it's just, but those type of people are attracted to other people that are just like them because of the law of attraction. I'm not gonna go watch Earl Nightingale's, or watch The Secret, the movie The Secret, just to get a concept of what the law of attraction is. But once everything's in tune and in harmony, magical things can happen. I did a CD, probably. It was me, Ryan Hall, Roddy Ferguson, Brandon Ver, Mike Fowler, called The Grappling Phenomenon. It was a real detailed look into what my process was, although my guys didn't even know what the process was. But it's, I call it the phenomenon. And now I'm getting ready to redo the Grappling Phenomenon with DJ and Keenan and Jimmy and JT, a bunch of the new guys, and redo it and expose it at even a bigger level. Because at some point, when Keenan went from not winning to winning double Grand Slam, he experienced what we call the Grappling Phenomenon. When he went from winning nothing to winning brown belt Grand Slam, he experienced what we call the Grappling Phenomenon. And DJ is a blue belt, silver medalist, purple belt world champion, brown belt world champion, no-gi blue belt world champion, no-gi purple belt world champion, no-gi brown belt world champion, and he experienced the phenomenon. Other people will say, oh, he had experience, oh, he was strong, oh, he's athletic, oh, he's a wrestler. Listen, if being strong, being athletic, being a wrestler was a prerequisite to grand slamming and becoming 3, 4, 5, 6 time world champions, then everyone would have them. But they don't. Once you're in a process and open your mind to the process and believe in the process and engulf yourself in the process, that then and only then you can experience the grappling, what I call the grappling phenomenon. You'll see people that have been in the process and have experienced the grappling phenomenon and then get out of a process and then it just goes away. What do you say about the grappling phenomenon? How it feels, like how everything is in line, like, you know, it's like, wow, like, no matter what happens.
Well, once you feel it for the first time, and you kind of understand.
Now, if you say feel it, they're going to think this is some total BS.
All right.
Don't say feel.
Well, so our hashtag.
But although you will feel it, so you'll know it.
It's like, I don't know. The only way I can really explain it right now.
All right, go say feel.
All right, so how I can explain it right now is like going through it. So like I said, it's all about think and grow. Everything right now is all about that think. Like you could read about it. You could read about it right. You could go online right now. You could buy it, you could download it legally, however you gotta get it, you could read this thing right now, and you could understand the philosophy. So
13 principles.
There's it is. Only 13 principles.
13 principles, built into our Metal Chaser program. 13 principles.
One book. One book. And one book you can understand.
One book that isn't even the real book.
Yeah.
It's an edited book. I have the real copy of the real one, but that's a whole other story.
So it's just like, I forgot, what were we talking about?
It don't matter. So, hey, let's end this. Right. Anything you want to say all to right. the guys like
yeah,
out there?
Yeah. So, one thing I want to say while we're on camera over here. So it's like the one thing I can't stand more than anything is people like I look on the forums because I've been going on the forums since I was 14 years old, 15 years old. Been going on the forums looking because I just love jiu-jitsu and that's it. Like I always want to read. The more it's in my life, the better it is. So I've been going on the forums since I was 14 years old. And now when I see people talking. Smack, talking bad about my instructor, talking bad, like all this stuff about my instructor, like it really, like, more than anything, it offends me because they don't understand how many people this dude is helping. So they say, like so for once, I see like specific things, like specific comments, Paul calling like loiter and scum of the earth, like stuff like this, like it's like that stuff, like hurts me, man, because it's real, you know, that this dude right here that you're calling snake oil salesman, all this stuff, blah blah blah, talking bad about him. This dude is helping more people than you'll probably help in your entire life. And he's making more people successful, helping more people's families than you'll ever help in your entire life. And the fact that you're talking smack about him is just like, I don't understand. I don't understand how it works. Like I said, I'm coming here as a kid. I'm 21 years old. I really don't know much about life yet. I'm just trying to get as much experience as I can. But I know that it's messed up because I know how many real people, not even just like me, like, me helping me do my whole thing and do whatever I want to do and put me in all these situations where I have all these opportunities to do whatever I want, go all over the world. Like I showed you my passport, like I've been all over. There's some stuff we can't even really talk about right now, like that where it's under wraps and like, but that's just how it is. That's how sick it is. And it's like the fact that people are out there, online, wherever they are, talking bad to just promoting this. False propaganda about, you know, this dude I see every day, and that this dude that helps me every day, and I see Like, I'm a person that's seeing what he's doing every day. Like, it's like there's no snake oil salesman. Like, I studied the marketing too. Like, there's none of that. Like, if you're trying to sell you some stuff that doesn't work, then you'd be a snake oil salesman. If I'm trying to sell you some stuff that I know I'm trying to scam you, then I know it's not going to work. I'm just trying to get your money. That's a different thing. But now he's a person that's taking the information that he's got through hard work and through struggle and through whatever.
Investment
and through investing in yourself and being able to put your money up so you know that you're going to get better. You're going to learn or doing situations where you know that you have nothing left. Like, for me, it was like I had really nothing left. Like, I dropped out of school. I was like doing nothing. I was like, you know what, man, I know it's going to work out for me. And luckily I was able to get into a situation where now I can work with Master Lloyd. And I can see how he works every day. And I know that when I watch him work, that's something that I can't do yet, but now it's something that I can model to, and I see it, and I see that it's possible. And that's super important. That's super important. If you don't see that it even exists, you're never going to do it. You know what I mean? So my investment was lucky that I got in at a point where now I'm involved in all this crazy, crazy, crazy stuff. You know what I mean? And I'm just chilling right now. So, yeah, man. I don't know, man. Like, me, it's so crazy, man.
I'm completely opposite. I do not care. Because everyone is talking, I already know who you are. I already know what category, whether it's 97%, 3%. I already know what category you're in. I already know if, when it comes to losing or winning in your life, I know where you're at. So it doesn't matter to me. Please, I beg you, please continue talking. Because as long as I keep doing what I'm doing, and as long as I keep putting out results, and as long as I keep on believing in what I believe in and going after my dreams, you know, the people that it makes angry who don't even know me, I don't care. So with that being said, I want everyone in the grappling community to strive to reach whatever their goals are. Make sure you have a goal. Make sure you have a plan to reach that goal, and make sure that plan is realistic. If you're not surrounded by people that can help you attain that goal, or you don't have people that can help you create a realistic goal, understand, this is not friendships, and this is not BS. You know, this is real. Can you realistically attain your goals? It's not about jiu-jitsu either. You know, whatever your goal is, you're never going to become rich fast with a regular job. All right. So if you want to become rich, like, job has to be somewhere else, or you have to have a plan to get out of the job. Right. You can make good money with a job, and I'm not knocking people that are employees, because in the real world, there's going to be businesses and employees, and without employees, people who want to work for others, who are the business owners going to hire, right? But I just want everybody to be successful. From me to you, I just want you to have success in whatever you do. All this 97% hate, all the 97% loserism, if that's a word, all the 97%, all the other stuff the 97% is doing, it's only hurting you. But it feels good because you're surrounded by other people that are 97%ers, and all 97%ers get in their own little herd and cheer each other on. That's what happens. And that's what our job as martial arts instructors, to make sure it does not happen. Because in my school, we have people that are, like, you know, a brand new student that comes in the very first day, whenever his first day of sparring, he gets his arm popped, he goes to the locker room, all the little sheep are in there like, oh, what's wrong? Oh, my elbow hurt. Oh, listen, you don't have to spar. You can just do the other. Like, see, now they're like, oh, I don't have to spar? So now that person who could have been a medal chaser, a world champion, one day down the road in 3, 4, 5 years, now gets pulled over into the locker room with the sheep, and he never even got a chance. So I have my locker rooms policed. All my athletes know, if you're in the locker room, you hear any white belt talking, any BJJ bitch asses, sit them down and talk to them. Because you have to give them the cure. You have to give them the medicine. If they do not have the medicine, it's going to continue over and over and over. That's about it. So all you 97%ers can take everything I said today, or whatever he said, and twist it, and, you know, come up with all the different things that you're going to say that I said that I didn't. And all to all the 3%ers, and all to all the supporters, thank you for the support. We're going to keep pushing forward, trying to reach our goals, helping all the other guys try to reach their goals. And like I said, if you've never heard my story, like I said, I started jiu-jitsu when I was 26 years old. I got my blue belt when I was 30 days in. My instructor left at 6 months. I got my black belt under 4 years with Leo Dallas, going back and forth to Brazil. He would come visit sometimes. But like I said, I truly and honestly believe that I never was able to reach my goal by not being able to create a be in an environment where people that were better than me on an everyday basis, getting my butt kicked, everyday basis, learning something, everyday basis, being in a room full of 3%ers. And when it came to creating the jungle house that the Metal Chasers live in, and creating the Metal Chasers, that's my entire goal. When one of my jiu-jitsu students, Roddy Ferguson, went to the Olympics, I went to the Olympic Training Center. I saw what they were doing, the whole Olympic Training Center, the whole philosophy, the mindset that came about, and I wanted to be able to create an Olympic Training Center for jiu-jitsu, although we're not in the Olympics yet, but an Olympic Training Center style where everyone at the OTC in Colorado, all of them want to be Olympians. All of them are the best from their area, and they're all housed at the Olympic Training Center trying to make the Olympics once every 4 years. So the Metal Chaser program is something that I hold very true to my heart, because it's something that I created because I would want to be a part of this program. Because I was in Maryland by myself, a blue belt, teaching a bunch of white belts. Like, I can only imagine what I could have done. And there's lots of people out there like that, and I've created the Metal Chaser program for that purpose, and we're having great success. And at the same time, when it's all said and done, unless they just don't want to, and I can't bust through the concrete and get them to understand that they need to learn other skill sets. So a lot of the guys here work on blogging at my school. They work on things other than just simply mopping mats. And then you got guys who, I don't want to learn any of that mats lore yet. I just want to focus on jiu-jitsu, and that's no problem. Like I said before, Jimmy took the last year off. I didn't say, oh no, you just did the Grand Slam. We have to keep on pushing towards this black belt. Listen. That's not what I'm about. That's not what it's about. Like, he's one of the guys that we're trying to progress up to the Black Belt World Champion, but he wanted to do something else. I'm like, oh, you have to know. It doesn't matter. Everyone can spread their wings wherever they want to go. I'm just here to be a catalyst. I'm just here to help them.
They don't know where up to, though.
They don't. Yeah. They don't. And that's my goal. So, like I said, all the supporters, I want to thank you for taking the time watching this long video. Hope you got some good pieces of information. And take care.